Hi, everybody. Good morning in Brazil. Good afternoon, good evening in India. I think everybody is listening us. Dr. Mukund, thank you very much for you here in this presentation, here in my channel, Paleobot Videos, Paleobotany and Paleknowledge for everybody. So I am here with this new look because I did the operation this week. Dr. Mukund, let me ask you one thing. When I am talking, you block your microphone. Yes. When I finish, I will block my microphone and you will start, okay? So, Dr. Mukund is scientist F in Bibalsan Institute of Paleobotany and sorry. Many problems are here with the
yes.
When I finish, sorry, 1 minute. I don't know what happened. So, Dr. Scientist Institute. I don't know what is happening. Many people together. Any problem starting here? Let's go to start again here. I don't know what is happening with the video. So, Dr. Mukund is scientist F in Bibalsan Institute of Paleoscience. He is interested in understanding the evolution of the early life on the Earth. Early diversification prokaryotic metabolism, radiation of eukaryotic forms, and large complex megascopic remains. Dr. Mukund, you can start to detail more your curriculum here, okay?
I can hear you. Okay. Good morning to all Brazilian students, friends. Are you listening me? Okay. So, you should now start. So here I start my presentation. It's a presentation for all the Brazilian friends. I'm going to talk about organic bald microfossils in the Proterozoic. And when I'm taking you,
first you talk more about your curriculum, your experience, okay? After you start your presentation, and I will share here. Don't worry, I put the screen in this model, but I will change.
For all the Brazilian friends, I'm going to talk about our bald microfossils.
Hello, I am Mukund Sharma from Birbalsan Institute of Paleosciences. And for the last 33 years, I am studying the Precambrian rocks of India. Fortunately, the one thing which is common with the Brazil is that it was a part of the Gondwana land. India, Australia, South Africa, Brazil, and we all were sharing a very number of Purana basins. This is a common term which is used here, that they are known as the Purana basins. And Purana basins are all Precambrian in age. So I started my work in one of the basins that is known as the Vindhyan basin. And gradually I shifted to the Archean successions, which are exposed in the South India and in some part of the Eastern East India. So considerable time was spent in locating for the stromatolites, the microfossils, and we were fortunate enough to record very good microfossil content from the Singhbhumi as well as from the Dharwar Craton. I have seen almost many of the Precambrian basins of the country, and everywhere I look for the fossils or the stromatolites, and that I have documented in a number of papers. Later on, I got interested in life on the other extraterrestrial planets. And in 2016, I convened a meeting along with the NASA in India, where we were looking for Mars analog life forms. And for that, we visited one of the localities in the Himalayas, which is having at one place very cold temperature, very high temperature, or hot springs were there, alkaline lakes, salt lakes, permafrost, and the cold desert was all there. In all these formations or all these areas, the people are studying that what type of life could be found. So this is an interest that any Precambrian paleobiologist can have. And after that, I visited two of the localities, one in Japan, where they were organizing such meeting, and subsequently one in Japan, in Tottori. So this is all my interest, that because of that, I was part of several international groups as well as units that which are studying the chronostratigraphy and the biostratigraphy of Precambrian rocks. This was the one thing. Besides that, for the people throughout the world, I organized two meetings. One meeting was in the Vindhyas, that is known as the field workshops. One field workshop was organized in the Vindhyas, and another was organized in Marwar supergroup in Rajasthan. I have also organized two other meetings. These meetings are very important in the sense that they call for all the people from different parts of the world to study the Precambrians of India. So that was the one good thing. And I'm still continuing there. Now I have a small group in the Birbal Sahni Institute of Paleosciences, where we are studying the fossils, and my team members are studying different basins of India. The results which I am showing is generated by some of my PhD students, some work has been done by me, and some my international collaborations. My international collaborations were mainly with the Russian people, the English people, the Americans, and the Australians. So we have a good connection throughout the world, and the Chinese also. I visited Nanjing Institute of Geology and Paleontology, where I have studied some of their classical sections, or the Yangtze God section. Likewise, I have visited in Australia some of the very good classical sections. So we have a fairly good idea what type of fossils are occurring in the different parts of the world. And I will be showing you the good fossils or the Proterozoic microfossils from the Indian successions. So I think it's sufficient for my introduction. And now I will take you to the journey of Proterozoic microfossils, which were recorded from the Indian succession. Please share. Dr. Sara, please share.
From the Indian succession. So I think
okay, Dr. Mukundi.
Yeah.
Dr. Mukundi, yes. When you finish your presentation, you can start, okay?
Okay, yeah.
Because the problem is here in my microphone. I don't know what okay. is happening. Are you listening?
So I want to make it the full screen. I want. Okay.
Okay. Okay. So I will share yes. your screen now, and you can start yes. your presentation. I'm sorry for yes. this problem. I don't know what's happened with my sure. microphone. Okay. Sure. Okay.
Yes.
When you.
So you make it the full screen. No, it's still not full screen. I want the full screen.
Doctor, I put now your full screen. You can start, okay?
Also, is okay. I have no problem. But on my computer, it is not a full screen. Okay, so I'm going to talk about the organic walled microfossils in the Proterozoic. And for the students of geology, they must be knowing. I should move. But it is not going the full screen and
right. Dr. Mukund, you have yeah. to click in your PowerPoint. In your point.
Yeah, yeah, I am that I am doing. It should work. No. Should go full screen. Not and it, even it is not changing. So there is some problem here. How to change the slide also? Not changing here from my side.
Changing.
Dr. Mukund, below yeah. on the right, below on the right, you will click in your PowerPoint, and you will share
your yeah, screen. I know, but it's not clicking. It's not changing the slide number. I want to go on the second slide. No, it should be on my screen.
Dr. Mukund, below
yeah.
on the right, below on the right, you will
yeah, I know.
In your PowerPoint, and you will share.
Yeah, I know, but it's not clicking. It's not changing the slide number. I want to go on the second slide.
I will do it again. Share is free. Share screen application window share
yeah I know
now it's working yeah
yes now it's working okay you can start.
Okay so as I mentioned that I will be taking you on the journey to the microfossil or organic walled microfossils world in the Proterozoic, and most of the examples which I am going to show you are from India and Russia, because I have done considerable work with the Russian scientists also. Since I mentioned this Proterozoic, all the students of the geology must be very well aware about this international chronostratigraphic chart, which is a division of different parts, different successions in the world. And this is the lower part is the Hadean, which is there are no records of the Hadean at present. Then it is followed by starting from 4,000 million year, going up to 2,500 million year, The time period is known as the Archean, and we do not have a very good microfossil record from the Eoarchean or the Paleoarchean, but indeed, yes, we have a very good Mesoarchean and Neoarchean fossil records. But today's topic is the Proterozoic. So Proterozoic start from 2500 million year and going up to the 541 million year time period. So it is almost, you can say, that the 2000 million year time period is here. But this entire succession is shown as a very compressed section here, starting from 4600 million year and going up to 541 million year. Whereas this particular section is known as the Phanerozoic, and which encompasses only 541 million year time period. And during this time period, the entire evolution which we see on the Earth took place in this period, and the people have documented different types of the fossils, different groups of the fossils, plant as well as the animals. But I will be talking to you only with the Proterozoic part, which is shown here, which is broadly divided into Paleoproterozoic, Mesoproterozoic, and Neoproterozoic. They are further divided. They are just chronostratigraphic markers. They're starting from 2500 million year and going up to the 1600 million year time period is a Paleoproterozoic. From 1600 to the 1000 million year time period is Mesoproterozoic, and is starting from 1000 million year going up to 541 million year time period is the Neoproterozoic. So these are the three broad divisions, and these are the further periods which in which the Proterozoic is divided. So now I will start how and what type of the fossils do we get in the Proterozoic. So Proterozoic microfossils, as far as the microfossils are concerned, these are very tiny, and mostly you see them under the microscope, but in some cases you can see a small specks on the rock surfaces also. And when you enlarge and see under the microscope, then you find that they are made up of some of the organisms. But they are found because of the antiquity of the age, antiquity of age as well as their nature. They are either found in the permineralized charts. Sometimes they are found in the carbonaceous remains in the clastic rock, that is the shale, a mudstone, silt stone. These are the rocks. Sometimes they are mineralized. They are entirely changed into the pyrite or phosphate, like that. Some minerals have taken over those organic remains, and they are mineralized. And in some of the cases, they are found as an impression forms. So the history of the fossil may start with the one question which was posed by the Charles Darwin. When he completed his book, he mentioned that although I'm propounding a very big theory, which says that the evolution took place on the Earth, but my story is only confined to the large creatures. I do not know the smaller parts, because the rocks which I've studied are from starting from Cambrian, when we get the trilobites. So he has written like that in his book. And I do not know the fossil contents which were just below the Cambrian rocks. So that was a very big dilemma for the Darwin, and that is known as the Darwin's dilemma. It is first book, first edition of his book, which is known as On the Origin of Species by Darwin. It was published in 1859 and released on 15th November by John Murray, London. So people always talk about this Darwin's dilemma. He mentions in the chapter 10 on the page 447 that if the theory of evolution be true, it is indisputable that before the lowest Cambrian stratum was deposited, the world swarmed with living creatures. Yet, why we do not find rich fossiliferous deposits belonging to these assumed earliest periods, I can give no satisfactory answer. The case at present must remain inexplicable, and may be truly urged as a valid argument against the views here entertained. So he was a very candid in admission that although he is propounding a theory of evolution, but he is unable to provide the complete set of answer that how the evolution has taken place, because he did not find small fossils. It was later on in the 20th century that people started finding the microfossils. And the first microfossil which was known to the world was by Tyler and Burgoon, a Canadian geologist and an American botanist, they prepared some thin sections of the gunflint iron formation, and in those gunflint iron formation chert, they saw microfossils. So that was the starting point of the journey of microfossils, real microfossils. Here now, once again, I will be showing you the geological time scale, the Proterozoic, which is known as divided into Paleoproterozoic, Mesoproterozoic, and Neoproterozoic, as I mentioned you earlier. Now, as I shown you that in which type of fossils they are found, they are found as a permineralized chert, they are found as a compression, they are found as a mineralized element or impression. So first, I will be showing you the permineralized cherts, which host lots of microfossils. And in fact, after the discovery by Tyler and Burgund, the people throughout the world started finding the microfossils in the chert. They looked for the chert, and many of them were successful in getting the microfossils. So this was the first time when a German scientist, Hans de Pflug, studied the Isua supercrustal belt rocks. And there in the chert, he found in the graphite and cherts, he found something very peculiar structure. So he said that these are likely some microfossils, although there is a very great debate whether these are the true fossils or not. But he studied with a Raman spectroscopy also and concluded that these are the organic remains found in the Isua supercrustal belt. But people throughout the world still do not consider these as a genuine fossil. So, but it is a very important thing that we have to find out the Cambrian fossils, Precambrian fossils, because that will help us in building our story of evolution on Earth and how the microfossils have gave rise to the advanced form. When I say the advanced form is starting from prokaryote, then eukaryote, and after that multicellular plant fossils or the animal fossils. Then there was one group in University of California, Los Angeles. The people studied the chert from different horizons, particularly in the Australia or in the South Africa. So they documented some of the filamentous form. These are where you see from the Krumbar formation in South Africa, they documented 1 to 2 micrometer broad filamentous forms. These are the narrow filamentous form. Then from the apex chert in Western Australia, the Schoff and Avramik and others, they documented fossils which are from the Mesoproterozoic and four micrometer broad filamentous forms were documented. These are again the microfossils, cellular filamentous fossils from Mount Ada basalt of Western Australia. This was reported by Avramik et al. In Precambrian research. So these are some of the earliest fossils in the Archean successions. I'm showing you all these things that the story starts from the Archean, but I will be broadly discussing and showing you the microfossils from the Proterozoic. Now you see, these are the Archean fossils from Australia, and these are the Archean fossils which we documented from old 3,000 million year old Dharwad supergroup of South India. So the Indian fossils are better preserved in comparison to these fossils. These are again the Archean fossils recorded from the Dharwad supergroup, and we named them as the Formidella sandorense, Formidella tinuae. These are the tinuous nature. On that basis, We mentioned that yes, these are the Formidella tinui and these are the Formidella sandorense specimens. Now coming to the after that, we studied the Vindhyan supergroup. As I mentioned, that most of the work which I have done is from the Vindhyan supergroup, and there is a one succession in the central India where on the granitic, the first sediments came on the Bundelkhand granite, which is an Archean succession, and there we found a very good fossil which is known as the Suyo Spiridium Echinoelatum and considered to be the means eukaryotic remains. And this vesicular diameter of this particular specimen is 260 micrometer. It has processes. If you see, the fine processes are there. Processes on the vesicle wall are present there. Then it has a central mass which we consider as an anion nucleus. You see, this is a further enlargement is present here. So on the basis, and this is the vesicular wall structure. So it, collectively, all these things indicate, yes, this is a genuine type of eukaryotic remain after the prokaryotes when they came into in existence. These are the some other fossils from the Chitrakoot area of the Vindhya supergroup or the Samri group, and they are just very well preserved, having a central nucleus like feature, and on the peripheral wall they have lots of pyrite present in them. So this is another specimen of the Cyanosporidium and Cymatosporidium culingi. This particular specimen is known as the Cymatosporidus culingi, not from the Chitrakoot formation. So you see, and they are the processes, they are again having a small processes here, you see, and they have the vesicular wall structure. These are other specimens of Cymatosporidus culingi acritarch population. They are commonly known as an acritarch. Then we conducted, we digested the chert material and taken out some of the organic remain found there. And when we put all those organic remain under the scanning electron microscope, we have documented these very beautifully preserved fossils. So you see, these are in the thin sections. So most of the things which I am showing you are in the thin section, and some are in the macerated residue. This is under the thin section. These are the macerated residue. These are all macerated specimens of Cymatosporidus culingi. Once again, the same fossils, and how they disrupture dehiscence, or they have a notch-like feature which is present here. You see now the Trachysporidium. There is another form of organic remain which was documented there from the Chitrakoot locality. So we documented very good eukaryotic remains. This is an advancement in the Proterozoic form. The Vindhyan supergroup is starting from 1700 million year. So that is an truly Paleoproterozoic succession in which we are finding these fossils. See, then we want to show that what is the specific nature of these fossils, and we consider it as an, why we consider it as an eukaryotic fossil. They are large size vesicles, they have processes present on their vesicle, variation in vesicle wall structure. Vesicle wall shows flexibility, it is a sufficiently thick structure. Then there are median splitting in the vesicles, then there is a nucleoplasm like feature present in the vesicle, and the nucleus in vesicle wall is also present. So collectively, all these things suggest that what structure we are seeing under the microscope in thin section, the chert rock thin section, is true eukaryote. And this is the one of the world's oldest eukaryote. This is the we can consider it as the oldest, and then after that there are the two other records. One is from the Ruyang group and another is from the Roper group. One is from China and another from Australia. So the Indian occurrence is the oldest occurrence of eukaryotic remain, and it is found in the Vindhyan supergroup. We did a lot of work, and that collective monograph was published in the Paleobotanist along with my Russian co-worker Sergey and another my student Yogma Shukla. So we together published a lot of documented in this monograph Proterozoic fossil cyanobacteria, which were published in a different scientific journal by different workers. So how and what type of fossils are those? Here we want to show you some of the line diagrams, that is the morphological types of fossilized cyanobacteria we are showing you here. These are again different types of the fossils which you can see here. This is a trichome here. This is a difference between the two walls structure. Sheath is present here. Trichome is there like that. And they are some of the acritarchs. These are some of prokaryotic remains. These are the two acritarchs which I am showing you, because they have the processes present on their surface. So how we study the fossils? First, what we do, we look for the chert, particularly the black chert or a light green chert. And if you find all this type of chert in the field, please correct that chert and then prepare thin section. And in thin section, on the gradual magnification, you will see this type of brown features, then the laminar features, and in those laminar features, some microfossils may be present here, and these are the enlarged version. So the next, in the next some of the slides, you, I will be showing you very beautifully preserved fossils, and they all are occurring in the chert. You see, this is by Bill Schaff's classical paper on the Bitter Spring Formation. That is an 850 million year. Similar age succession from India, we have documented the microfossils with the filamentous microfossils as well as the sheets also. Here again, the coccoid microfossil belonging to Crococcaceans cyanobacteria. This is from the Bitter Spring Formation, and here in this case, we have documented from the Deoban limestone formation. Again, these are the beautifully preserved protist fossils from the Deoban. They are the eukaryotic in nature. These are the acritarchs. Again, eukaryotic fossils. These are the cyanobacterial remains, and this is also all cyanobacterial remains. This is known as the Aubrechella, which is a very, very characteristic of very close to found, very close to the Precambrian Cambrian succession throughout the world. When you will prepare a thin section of the chert, in some cases, what you will find, they have a radiating fan fabric structure. And in these fan fabric structures, sometimes the organic remains are just found floating on that. So gradual magnification will show you different types of the fossils in them. So these are the fossils which we have seen in the chert, once again from the Vindhyan supergroup. And this is the formation known as Salkhan limestone. In Salkhan limestone, there are the chert specks, and in that chert specks, we have found very good fossils. And these are the characteristics circumvaginalis. These are look equal to the entophysalid. And this is supposed to be the one of the oldest entophysalid remains from the world. Entophysalis is the one cyanobacteria which evolved around in the Paleoproterozoic and even continuing today. If you go to the, any pond, and then you will find in that pond water, you will find Entophysalis is growing there. Then there is a sometime what happens that you get acritarchs, and acritarchs are definitely eukaryotic remains. And when you digest the clastic rock, then these are released from the matrix, and you can study all those fossils. They are variously named, but sometimes they are very good biostratigraphic markers. And here they all are been recorded from the Sucus shale formation. And in the Sucus shale is Paleoproterozoic. But what is happening is that is in a very big debate in Indian geology, that these are the Ediacaran complex acanthomorphic acritarchs from the lower Vindhyan. So the age of the succession is 1600 million years, but the fossils which are occurring in those rocks are Ediacaran, a complex acanthomorphic acritarch. So this is a very big question, and we are trying to solve this question, but so far we are unable to give satisfactory answer or satisfactory conclusion how and why we are these fossils are occurring in a very older rocks. These are again helically coiled microfossil Aubrechella, which have been recorded from the Oak shale in the South Indian. Again, this particular fossils are found very close to the Precambrian-Cambrian boundary. And this is a published record. So on the basis of these fossils, we not only draw conclusion or lesson of the evolution, as well as we can date some of the horizons which are otherwise difficult to date, because we seldom get a very good igneous rock or the suitable rock for dating in the Precambrian succession. So you have to rely on the fossils and fossil content. If you get some very good index fossils in those rocks, then on the basis of that organic remain, you can date the particular band in which those fossils are occurring. You see the other fossils occurring from the in the Oak shale. They are having a very good acritarchs, the Chuaria remains, and then the Leospherids. They all are occurring in the same bed. This is a classical Chuaria specimens from the Kurnool Basin, which have been recorded. So that is then a very good thing that Chuaria starts from 1600 million year and going up to the Precambrian-Cambrian boundary. And here, these beautifully preserved microfossils are occurring in an outshale of the Kurnool group. Kurnool Basin. Then these are some of the echinids which have been recorded from the Shulkan limestone formation, Shulkan limestone of the Vindhyan supergroup. Echinids are those remains which, due to the harsh condition, they go in the slumber, or they become inactive, and after some time when the situation is favorable, then they germinate itself and give rise to the another colony of microorganisms or cyanobacteria. Mostly these are the cyanobacterial elements, but they indicate that the environment, depositional environment, became suddenly inhospitable or harsh, and in that harsh environment these are the organisms which are generally found. So we have documented this type of fossils also, and we concluded that during the deposition of the Shulkan limestone formation, there were some time when the depositional environment was not very favorable for the luxuriant growth of microorganisms, and these are the organisms which were just to survive themselves, they made double walled structures, and they made themselves the dormant structure. On the basis of that, we concluded that these are the organisms, and such organisms should be available in the extraterrestrial environment also, if the environment is very harsh. So this is the one lesson which we learned. If we want to conclude that what type of organisms we can found in the on the Mars environment or some other planets of the our solar system, so we can look for the similar thing. You see the other type of microfossils from the Russians, Mesoproterozoic microfossils from the Kutikon and Yuzmastok formation from the Siberian region, and they are the very good fossils, very well preserved fossils are there. So I want to show you the like the Circumvaginalis is here, like Gliodenopsis is here, this is an acritarch is here. So these are the fossils, and some echinids are also present here, you see. And then there are the large size microfossils from the Shulkan limestone, once again from more than 1600 million year age of the chert. So these all are permineralized, they are found in the permineralized chert formation. Large size coccoid fossils and very large size coccoids, these all are occurring in the Shulkan limestone. Here Gliodenopsis is there, the single double walled structures, then the two divisions are there, the three divisions are there, and these are the Spheriophycus fossils are all occurring. Different types of fossils are found in the chert. Large size microfossils from again from the Shulkan limestone formation, you can see. Now these are the characteristic fossils, similar type of fossils in the chert, found in the chert of the Russia, of Russian succession. You see, Crococcygian cyanobacterium genus Gliodenopsis. This is the characteristic Gliodenopsis is here, recorded from the Russian succession. This is a part of our monograph on the cyanobacteria. Now you see Aubrichiella. As I mentioned, that these are the very typical index fossils which occur very close to the Precambrian and Cambrian succession. So these are recorded from the Russian succession, and here in India we have recorded from the outshale end of the Kurnool Basin, and they are also recorded from the Kroll Belt in the Taal succession. This is an Circumvaginalis and a specimen from Harmogonian cyanobacterium genus Circumvaginalis. This is recorded from Russian succession, and we have also documented it from the Vindhyan supergroup. Another Harmogonian cyanobacteria genus, Phylliconstrictus, Schauff and Partitiophyllum. These are the lower ones are the Partitiophyllum, and whereas the topmost are the Phylliconstrictus specimens from Russian succession. This is the Polybasaurus, stalked cyanobacteria. You see, when this particular cyanobacteria is growing, there is leaving a sheath here, and that is how it is growing up, up and up. So the succession, the annular nature of the sheath is present here. And when you cut a thin section, a section of this particular cyanobacteria, you will see this type of feature. So this is a growth pattern which is preserved here in the chert. And here it is a section which we are seeing in one part. Then again, the archaeoelipsoid is echinids of Nostocalian is Stigmatalian cyanobacterian genus archaeoelipsoid is. You see, there is a one division my friend Sargeev has given that he calls as the Anabarian protoral horizon. That means the lowermost part of the Paleoprotozoic or Mesoprotozoic. Topmost part of the Paleoprotozoic and lowermost part of the Mesoprotozoic is a one succession where we get this type of fossil. So if we are getting or somebody is getting this type of fossil, he can fairly confidently say that he is dealing with the rocks which are earliest Mesoprotozoic succession. And this is the division and the distribution of different types of fossils, which I had shown you from the in the previous slides. So you see all these things, they started from Paleoprotozoic in the earlier part of the Paleoprotozoic. And as I mentioned, the protistent fossils are here, Polybasaurus is here, and the division and acritarchs, they all started from the middle part of the Mesoprotozoic, and then they go up to the Wendian or the Cambrian succession. They continue up to this part, you see. This is a thin section of Achuaria carbonaceous specimen, that how they look like. On the shale slab, you will see that the dark brown spots are there. But if you see under the microscope, then you will find that they have the perforated nature, and these are the double walled structure. We conducted some TEM, transmission electron microscopic scopic studies of those fossils, and that suggests that the Achuaria is the double walled structure. Now I will be showing you some of the mineralized. As I mentioned, these were the permineralized, means that they were the exclusively found in the chert. But in some cases, what happens that they are not replaced by chert or the silica, whereas they are replaced by the phosphate or the pyrite. So here in this section, I will be showing you the fossils which are mineralized. Now these are the beautifully preserved Rafflesiamia chitrocotensis, one fossil which are found in the phosphatic rock of the Indian supergroup, which is exposed in the Janki Kund locality. And the age of that particular stromatolite and the phosphate bearing unit is 1640 million years. So we are distinctly in the Paleoprotozoic, and in the terminal part of the Paleoprotozoic, we have a very beautiful preserved fossil. These were reported by Bengston et al. In 2017. And these are some of the fossils. They have shown very well preserved evidence of oxygenic phototrophy in ancient phosphatic stromatolite from the Paleoprotozoic Windian. So these all are the successions from the Paleoprotozoic Windian, and the same spot from where the previous slide has shown very good fossils. You see the thallus, it is known as the Ramathallus lobatus specimen. The three-dimensional preservation of cellular and subcellular structure suggests 1.6 billion year old crown group of red algae. So these are the red algal fossils. Then these are the specimen from different localities where they have, in the China, they have recorded Angiophyton lineatum and Flabellophyton and Ausontophyton. And all these are invariably converted in the pyrite. So you see the primordial pyrite is found here. So the specimens are entirely converted into pyrite. So for the making of the pyrite at this particular spot, reducing conditions were there. Sulfur oxidizing bacteria was there, and that has formed the pyrite. And these pyrites are just replace the organic material found in the fossils. These are the other pyritized microfossil assemblies from the 2.1 BA old Gabon. So these are the structures when they conducted the studies, then they found that they are made up of distinct pyrite. See, these all are from the Gabon area, France Valley series. Then comes the carbonaceous remains and the clastic rocks. As I mentioned, the sums of the shale, siltstone, mudstone, they contain very good fossils on the surface. They all are very, very small fossils. We can call them as a macrofossils or microfossils, because for the study of the finer features, we have to go, or we have to see those organisms or the fossils under the microscope. So that is why I have included those fossils as the carbonaceous remains in the clastic rock. So these are the famous Chuaria Tawiya assemblage from the Sukkot Hills of India. So a lot of work has been done by different workers. We have also conducted work, and there we have proved the relationship between these particular organisms and these organisms. You see, the variety of Chuaria circularis and morphological differentiation in the Chuaria, which are recorded from the Sukkot shale as well as from the Halkar shale. You see, now, and then the other fossils are also recorded, which are known as the annulated carbonaceous fossils, Proto-Arenicola, Para-Arenicola, from the Neoproterozoic Halkar formation of the Bhima Basin. That was published in the Geological Society, London. So we have documented all these fossils previously. The rock units which were hosting all these organisms were considered as 1,000 million year old, but we concluded no, but these advanced forms could be found only very close to the Ediacaran successions or the Cryogenian successions. Then here again the Tawiya, these are the long tubular forms are known as Tawiya dalensis, and these are known as the circular annulated structures are known as Chuaria circularis, and the wide variety of Chuaria circularis morphology are found in the Vindhyan succession. And there was a need to establish a relationship why this particular Chuaria like feature is present here and then the tubular form is present here. One circular concentric ring structure is present here and then the tubular form is there. So we have conclusively proved that there is a relationship between the tubular form and the circular form. You see this particular structure here. And here, this is known as the Tawiya, which is filled with lots of Chuaria specimens. And then what is happening is when the carbonaceous remains, the Chuaria, attains a large size, then at particular time, a point of time, that it gets a medial split. And due to the medial split, the entire protoplasm, which is converted into a smaller type of Chuaria, they are released in the environment and start a new generation of the Chuaria. These are the striated eukaryotic fossils known as Valeria lophostrata from the Chhattisgarh supergroup. And these are the carbonaceous microfossils from the olive shale of the same regroup, which is again around 1640 million year old succession. So these type of fossils are present in the Paleoproterozoic. And these are the beautifully preserved clastic released from the clastic rocks and known as the acanthomorphic accreta Tapania plana. So this is a 1.5 GA means giga, 1,500 million or 1.5 billion year old Saraipalli shale of the Chhattisgarh supergroup, in which we have found these fossils. So these are typical eukaryotic fossils. Similar fossils were recorded by our friend N.J. Butterfield from different localities. This is the red algae from 1200 million year old. Whereas if you remember in the previous slide, in the mineralized fossils, I had shown you red algae which was recorded from Janki Kund section, that is a 1.6 billion year old. So there is that is an oldest record of benjimorph, the red algae in the Indian succession. You see, there is another probable fungi, Tapania plana, from 1430 million year old. And this type of fossils we have recorded from 1.5 billion year old. So in Indian succession is a very rich succession, which has yielded some of the very old fossils, or the it has raised the antiquity of different fossils at certain level, which is still older from the other areas of the world. This is another fossil, Jacutia nema solubila. So these are the different fossils. You see the single, then double, the triple. So these are another, how the division has taken place, and this is how they are germinating. They all are occurring in the 1.1 GA old Chapradir formation of Chhattisgarh supergroup. Now here comes a connection between the single cell forms, and then they started talking to each other. We can say that these cells are passing in formation from one region to another region. So these are the, in true sense, they are the multicellular. Otherwise, the prokaryotic colonial forms cannot be considered as a multicellular, although they may look like a multicellular form, but they were not transferring any information here. Whereas these formations transfer information one cell to another cell. Then another complex acanthomorphic epitaph from the lower meninges, they are occurring in the Stuckey cell equivalent rocks. But the big puzzling question is, how come these Ediacaran complex acanthomorphic acritarchs are occurring in the 1600 million year old rocks? You see, some of the very beautifully preserved fossils are here. So there are so many names. These are known as the Appendiosphaera fragilaris, these are known as the Appendiosphaera grandis, and these are known as the Appendiosphaera tabifica. You see, these are again the Ediacaran complex acanthomorphic acritarchs, which are occurring in the 1600 million year old. So this is a big question, but because I mentioned these are the Ediacaran complex acanthomorphic acritarchs. In other parts of the world, these particular fossils are found only in the rocks which are Ediacaran succession. And Ediacaran is a time period which starts from 635 million year to 541 million year. And towards the topmost part, around 580 million years, such type of fossils start occurring. Whereas in the Indian succession, they are found just in the one succession, which is 1600 million year old. So this is a good question. Now you see, this is the Ceratosporidium glabrosum, and some Archaeocanthodae, Dicroidium flaxispinosum, Cava spina acuminata, 5 and 6 are, these are the 5. And 7, 8 is a Cava spina bisiconica. These are some of the different names of the fossils which are occurring in the Proterozoic succession. Once again, the puzzling thing is the occurrence of Vendotinia in the Stuckey cell. So there is a lot of debate which is going on in the, not only the Indian geologists, but throughout the world. How come the Ediacaran succession fossils are occurring in the 1600 million year old? And that needs a suitable explanation. Then comes another form, which is known as the carbonaceous mega remain, which you can see by naked eye. In some of the forms, which are very smooth one, and in some you can see the septation structure is also present. You see the first well identifiable biostratigraphic marker. This is a topotype material from Tikaria Katni, MP in India. And these are known as Grapinia spiralis, and this from C to G is a Katania Singhi, because in Katania Singhi we see the spine separation, whereas in the Grapinia spiralis we do not see any separation in them. So this is another fossil which you can see by the naked eyes. But we conducted an experiment on the basis of Nostrop commune, and we came to the conclusion, previously the people were considering all these forms as a eukaryote, but we established, we conducted a study and came to the conclusion that they are like Lingvia or Oscillatoria, which are larger in size. And in fact, they are the prokaryote, not the eukaryote. But the Grapin, means Bruce Roeniger and other people are still considering them as an eukaryotic remains. So I leave this thing as an open question, whether we should call the Grapinia and Katania as a eukaryotic remain or prokaryotic remain. But we are of firm belief that they are the prokaryotic remain of extra gigantic size. Then comes the impressions. In some cases, what is happening is that we do not get any carbonaceous remain attached with them, but we get only the impressions. And these are the impressions fossils from of the Katania Singhi, Grapinia spiralis, Pyrospignus, Beerii, and Chuaria specimen. These are the Chuaria specimens, where no carbonaceous remain is present, only the impression is present. These are also the, again, the impression fossils of Prototinia, Prototinia cataniensis, Graphinia spiralis from Bamungaung. So I started my lecture with Darwin, because he mentioned the on the origin of a species and the survival of fittest is attributed to Darwin. So what is the best thing which is continued from Precambrian till date? So the answer will be cyanobacteria. You see, the lots of fossils I have shown belong to the cyanobacteria. They evolved in the Precambrian and they are still continuing, whereas many other forms evolved and then they vanished away, or they died, or due to the catastrophic events or activities, they were just obliterated. So Darwin addressed two most important questions of evolution: origin of a species and survival of the fittest. And if we go by the survival of the fittest, then the cyanobacteria is the best element, the best organism, which is having a tendency of fittest organism throughout the entire geological history. So we will call it the cyanobacteria, the fittest organism evolved on Earth. Now finally I came to the conclusion. So whatever I have presented, I have learned throughout my studies, or through the studies of my one of the friend, late Dr. V. and Sergey, Nicholas Butterfield, J.W. Shaw, and Shuhai Zhao. I acknowledge the help extended by my lab teammate, Viru Kant Singh, S.K. Pandey, Arif Ansari, Yogmaya Shukla, Shamim Ahmed, and Yogesh Kumar. Divya Singh is the new research scholar which has joined our group, and Archana Sunkar extending us the technical help. Finally, I would like to put on record thanks to Sara Gonzalez, and because I have taken liberty of taking some of the specimens from the published record, which is allowed under the Creative Commons Attribution License. So we thank to all of them. Thank you. Thank you.
Hello, are you listening to me now? Are you listening now?
Yes, I'm listening to you.
First of all, sorry for those problems. When you start your presentation with the microphone, I had problems here with my microphone, so sorry. And the second thing, thank you very much, Dr. Mukundi, for your presentation. Very good presentation, very complete presentation. I like it a lot, and people in Brazil like it also. But I have here some questions to do. Okay. And as I told you before, this presentation is recorded, okay? So I will share it, and people can in the future ask you more things by mail, by network. Okay, so let me ask you one thing here. People say that dinoflagellates came from Acritarchy that lived in Proterozoa. Do you believe in it? Really, you think dinoflagellates come from Acritarchs?
Yes, I also believe, but so far we have not found the chemical compound in those Acritarchs. Although the morphologically many features are very similar to the dinoflagellates. That is why the people consider that the dinoflagellates have originated from the Acritarchs. But it is yet to be established that they are the correct ancestors of dinoflagellates. Some of the Acritarchs are correct ancestors of dinoflagellates. So it is yet to be established, because we get the dinoflagellate in the Phanerozoic rocks and no evidence of dinoflagellate in the Precambrian. But some morphological features are very similar. That is why the people consider it as belonging to the same lineage.
Okay. Okay. And let me ask you more. In India, are there studies about these relations between Akhtarchs and the dinoflagellates?
Pardon?
In India, are there publications, studies about these relations between Akhtarchs and dinoflagellates?
No, not at present.
Okay. One more thing. And about fungi, studies about fungi in Proterozoic. In India, are you studying about the fungi in this period of the time?
Proterozoic. So I could not follow. Please repeat your question. No.
Oh, sorry.
In India.
Sorry for my terrible English, but you understand. In India, are there many works with fungi in this period of the time?
Who are Proterozoic? Studying?
Studies, papers, how are the studies about fungi in India in this period of the time, in Proterozoic? Are you studying in India more about fungi in
Proterozoic time? Many people who are studying the Proterozoic microfossils. So, like the Birbal Sahni Institute, some 5 persons are studying it. Then in Lucknow University, then there is another institution in Dehradun, and then in some other universities, people are studying the fossils, particularly the Proterozoic fossils.
But fungi.
We call it a fungi.
Yes,
so far the people have not studied the fungi in Precambrian, but in the younger strata people have studied and they have contributed a lot from the Birbal Sahni Institute of Paleosciences. Also there is a one Dr. R.K. Saxena who has written a very good book published by the American Stratigraphic Stratigraphers, and then the Dr. S.K.M. Tripathi, they have published a good record of fungi from the Phanerozoic succession. But I am optimistic and confident that in the future we may find good fossils, or we may be able to establish good fungi record from the Precambrian also. Maybe in the later part of the Proterozoic. Yes.
I could not
understand. You were calling fungi, and yes, some people call it the fungi, but here in India we call it the fungi or fungus. So
there was I am asking this period, Proterozoic, fungus in Proterozoic. If you have found this kind of microfossils in your studies, was the question. Mm-hmm. So let me see if any person wants to ask more. Francisco, in general, always asking, but today I don't know what happened. He didn't ask anything. Francisco always asks some things, but I don't know. Today he didn't ask anything. Anybody else want to? Francisco, he asking. Are you seeing this? His question. See his question, Dr. Mukundi.
Where to see it in the chat box?
Francisco asked the one thing. Please, yes. You answer.
Please come up with question. Yes.
Celissa, are you reading question? He writes his question for you. Are you seeing this question or not?
Okay. It is already in full screen for ourselves. We are viewing full screen. Hi, dear Deepa. I'm okay.
Below. Is the last
question? Cyanobacteria was important in iron deposition in Proterozoic. Could you identify the most important ones which contribute to that deposition? Okay. Francisco Silva. Francisco. Cyanobacteria gave rise to the oxygen. They were not directly responsible for the precipitation of iron. Because of the oxygen released by cyanobacteria through their metabolism, that has helped in the deposition of iron which was dissolved in the seawater. So, this is not one specific cyanobacteria which was responsible for deposition. You have asked, could you identify the most important ones which contribute to that deposition? No, I would say that any one species was responsible. They all were collectively giving you oxygen in the environment, and that was dissolved in the water, and then due to the reaction, the iron was precipitated.
Okay. Thank you for your answer, Dr. Mukund. Dr. Mukund, let me ask you one thing, but for a student. Suppose one student wanted to study with you about these microfossils in Proterozoic in India. Is possible for a student go to study with you?
Oh, yeah, they all are welcome. And I think there is a lot of scope because, as I mentioned in my opening statement, that we all were part of the same supercontinent that is known as the Gondwana supercontinent. And the Brazil is also having a very extensive pre-Cambrian succession, which are known as Parana basins. So, in the Parana basins, we have a lot of sedimentary rocks. I'm sure that they must also be having good charts. And if you collect those charts, prepare thin sections, you can find very beautiful fossils. And I am still to look for good fossils, because there is only one or two persons whom I know that they are working on the Precambrian. One is in the São Paulo, that is a Thomas Fairchild, and then is there one more person, S.K. Srivastava. S.K. Srivastava in La Habra. He's also in São Paulo, working on Precambrian stromatolites, but not the microfossils. So there are a lot of things are yet to be explored in Brazil.
Okay. So people, any question? If you want to do any question, people want more question? No. So okay, if people are in the future wanted to ask more things to Dr. Mukund, you can send email, maybe.
Dr. Mukund, could you
I think it's possible you write your email here. Your email.
I have given my email in the very first slide. It is Mukund _Sharma. Yeah, it is given there.
Because in this moment there are not many people here these things because of the time, but when I share this presentation, many people will watch and maybe questions will come.
Give me also the link. I will share it with other people, many other people also.
Okay. I will give you the link, okay? Again, Dr. Mukund, thank you very much for you coming here in my channel. Thank you very much for you here in Brazil to present this amazing lecture. And thank you, Birbal Sun Institute of Paleoscience, for a lot of Dr. Mukund here. And thank you very much for everybody that come here to watch this presentation. I am very happy.
Yeah, it is almost 20 years ago. I visited Rio de Janeiro, attending the Geological Congress in 2000. I came there, and I very much remember the Rio de Janeiro hospitality and the many places, particularly the Christ the Redeemer, the place which I have visited there. Yeah. So once again, thank you, Sarah, for giving me this opportunity.
Okay. Yes. India is always in my art. Everybody in India is always in my art. I like the scientists from India a lot. They work hard. They do good works. Even I think in paleobotany and paleontology, Indians are the best of the world. I think this is my point of view. India are very good.
Thank you.
Good work, good papers, good things. So again, thank you very much. Let me go now. I will share your presentation here, Dr. Mukund, and in the future, more lectures here. Okay?
Okay.
So, people, thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.